profesor que se tiene que profesar que defender cuando puedo. Profesor, el defender los grupos de sí, es que he from the army, es que he was and defender from the
1995. He is a research professor and the head of the Nature, Language and Text Processing Laboratory of the Center for Computing Research of the National Polytechnic Institute, Mexico, since 1997. He was the invited professor of the National University of Colombia and the University of Central Europe, Slovakia. He is academician of the Mexican Academy of Sciences since 2000 and a national researcher of Mexico since 1998. Currently, with excellence, he is of the excellence level 2. He is the secretary of the Mexican Society for Artificial Intelligence. Professor Gurbukh's main areas of interest include computational linguistics and artificial intelligence. He is the author and editor of more than 370 scientific publications, co-author of 3 books. He has received he has been the advisor of 12 PhD dissertations defended in Mexico, Finland, South Korea and Colombia. He was the principal investigator of several projects funded by the Mexican government. Besides that, he is a member of editorial board and reviewer for a number of international journals on computer science and artificial intelligence. Professor Gurbukh is a founder and chair of the CIC series of international conference on computational linguistics and intelligent text processing. He has been program committee member of about 100 international conferences and chair, honorary chair or program committee chair of more than 20 international conferences. In particular, he has been 4-time program committee co-chair of the Mexican International Conference on Artificial Intelligence. He was also the distinguished lecturer for the ACM program for Mexico and Central America. So I invite Professor Gurbukh for his lecture. Thank you.
Thank you.
Some words about it later. We give very good scholarships.
If you're a professor, we can share the student. So now I will speak about this task, later about our techniques, and we'll say some words about our scholarships. Now, why should we need opinion mining and sentiment analysis? Because of some problems in how our society works. For the businesses, how the businesses operate. They produce a product, a service. The product sells or does not sell. If the product does not sell, then the company goes bankrupt. So it's a process of trial and error. We try, it works or does not work, and then with such a nature of selection that companies survive and improve, but it's inefficient way of improvement. For better improvement, the companies need to know what specifically the users think about their products, not just buy them specifically, buy or not buy the product. And the users need to know what experience other users had with the products that the user wants to buy. Again, because when I buy a phone, it's a process of trial and error. I buy this phone, this is Polaroid, very bad phone, and then I already paid for it, so I am reluctant to change it because the next one will be also bad. Then things that I use, it's again a process of trial and error, very slow and inefficient. In politics, the same problem. So we vote for this guy, and okay, you know. And then we vote for another guy against this guy. We cannot vote against, so we have to vote for somebody just to vote against this guy. Again, the next one will probably be even worse. For better improvement in our political development, where we don't risk just a form, we risk our society, the peace of the world, our planet. So the parties need to know what specifically people want, not just binary decisions, what for or against. We as citizens need to know what others think and others know about political candidates. Say we live in democratic countries, but then the democracy as we can apply it, we apply it once in 4 years. We vote for somebody, then we realize an error, and then we have to wait 4 years to vote for another candidate against this one. In these 4 years, there's no democracy, because I as a citizen cannot influence the political process with my vote. I have to wait 4 years. What democracy is this? The solution to this kind of problem, to inefficient improvement, natural selection kind of a problem. The solution is what we call business intelligence, the technologies of business intelligence for the companies, decision support systems for politicians, for parties, and for us, the end users. We call this technology recommender systems, computer programs that help us to make an informed decision. also being a civilization, for me not to read thousands, millions of opinions about something, but get a report of what people think about this product, service, public figure. The users for such technology is for the companies to improve in this form. What specifically should be improved? I can say it's polite, it's extremely bad, this flash. Extremely bad of this one. It's Polaroid. But then, how can I tell this to the company? How the company can know that I will never buy Polaroid phones because I did not like the flashlight here? Where and what, to what type of people to sell this model? Because it can be sold well in Africa, but not so well in America. For us, the end users, the questions which I want to get answers to is when I see this phone in the store, is this one good one? Should I buy it? What specifically is good or bad about it? I said the flashlight is very bad, but maybe you don't need the flashlight. It's irrelevant for you. So what specifically is good or bad, of what would matter for me, not in general, but what matters for others? Or, just like which one should I buy? Basing on the opinions of other people. Another use for this kind of technology is to predict the future, to prepare ourselves for the future. In elections, who will win? It seems very easy question, but now with the US elections, for example, we have seen that the experts had a very different idea of who would win in, these elections. Company stock prices, exchange rates, development of the market, this popular opinion, market predicted, we now work also in this area, as an example, I recall in 98, with a quite bad crisis in Russia when the exchange rate just soared 10 times probably. The experts said it was completely unexpected. Nobody could predict that financial crisis, but then Russian search engine, Google did not exist yet, I think, but a Russian search engine published the fact that 1 week before the crisis really happened, there was a sharp increase in search queries on exchange rate for dollar. So people already knew it. I don't know how, but people knew it and the experts did not know. Now when we can mine for people's opinions, we can detect such things in time to prepare ourselves. The future of technology, many of you are learners. How many years you wasted learning the flash technology? And now it's dead, now it's just wasted time. Which technology is next? Which will disappear next, not to waste my time on it? Which technology will come next? Okay, so these are good questions, and people already tried to answer such questions in the past using questionnaires. Now with the questionnaires, for example, the company can ask people who bought their product whether they are satisfied. Probably they are satisfied because there was some reason to buy this product. But now you cannot ask people who did not buy this product. Now this new technology has become this old way. There was no way. Me as end user, how did I in the past solve those questions to know which product is good? Well, from advertising, if the company says this is number one on the market, it should be, or no? From friends, but how many of my friends bought this this specific model of the phone? From rumors, very unreliable, very inefficient. When there was so little information, then only information about specific big selected things was available. So we could know quite a bit of a public figure, we could know quite a bit of an important place, quite a lot of an important place, but then no way to get information on specific, not that important. So this Polaroid phone is not that internationally well known. So when there was little information, there was no way to get information about it. And now the game changer is big data. When there is enough information to collect about some specifically, not public figure, anybody of you, internet knows a lot about anybody of us, nearly about any person in the world. Here is a world of quotation marks. It's a world of people who can use internet, who has access to internet, and it's the same people who have money to buy something. Then it's the same people who have some opinion about things they have bought, and those who are future customers for the companies. So it's world of people involved in such relationships. Of course, I guess in Africa there are people not involved in this world. So this is why I use quotation marks here. And then now we have enough information on each specific model of the phone, on some part of this phone, the camera of this phone, on the flashlight of this phone. With this enough information, we can leverage it to answer those questions. There's a change which we did not have before, enough information. The area of opinion mining then is busy collecting and summarizing opinions on some product, issue, public person, but I want to emphasize not important person, not important place, but a specific small, this one, which I see now in the store, and I'm thinking buy it or not, this one. So I have a dream of a world where we all can listen to others, can know opinions of others, when I would not only be guided by my personal experience, but by experience of all people in the world. And when I could contribute to the experience of all people in the world, when I buy something that doesn't work, now all people will know that it doesn't work. When I want to suggest or prove something, now all companies will know that this should be improved. For businesses, it is better income. For users, it's better products and better services in two different ways. One, direct. I would just buy good phone, and I would not buy this phone, and would not waste my money on it. And indirectly, when I To begin with, I don't like this website. Okay, at that moment, the company will know to improve, will improve it, and my next phone will be better because they listen to me, because I could influence their decisions, not just binary, not binary, not binary, but directly telling them what to do. Informed government, which now would be democracy in real time. Democracy right now, not in 4 years. In big things, okay, solution to migration crisis in Europe. Okay, this is big thing, more or less everybody knows the opinion of people on it. But now, when I go out in the night and the light post doesn't work in front of my house. Well, I could go to the local administration, file a report about it, I would do it. I would just tweet, okay, no light on my street in front of my house. Before, I would wait for years to vote against that administration that is not capable to repair this light. Now, I just tweet, they can collect our opinions and repair it. So this is democracy. I can influence the operation of my government right today, directly. Sentiment analysis is the main part, I perceive it as main part of mining for opinions. There are different definitions of it. Some people say that opinion mining and sentiment analysis is the same. It's okay, I just don't read it. In some papers you will find it as a synonym of opinion mining. It's okay. My personal feeling is that we should distinguish between the two stages of opinion mining. Taking one document, analyzing one document, mainly analyzing the emotions effect sentiment in this document, and building a database of such the results of such analysis, and then mine in this database to get a summary of opinions of those mining documents. So my personal opinion is that we should call analysis this part, and not the mining part. Today we'll speak about analysis in this part. I will not speak about mining part, which is very good, very important part, just I cannot speak about it. I will speak about this part. So, in the analysis for each document, I will want classification, very simple tasks, classification tasks. What sentiment the document expresses, positive, negative, we call it polarity, or what emotion, we usually work with six different emotions. Whether when somebody sends a tweet about a political figure, so is the author joyful about it, or angry, or ashamed, or frightened. Even if the opinion is negative, but it could be shame, could be anger. Okay, now if you know that the document says, okay, good, but with what? You will need to find the object of this opinion. Then who expresses this opinion? You will want many different kinds of information about the author of this opinion. For some applications, it is important. It is important who specifically, I mean, not the name, but characteristics of the author. A very important part is opinion spam filtering, because of course, all the rest, all the works, if you know which opinions are real. Then you can ask many other questions about a given document. By document, I mean a tweet, a review, a post on Facebook, many other questions like, but what time the opinion is? Not exactly when it was given, but somebody can say, okay, 10 years ago I did not like smartphones, but now I enjoy them. There are two different opinions about different times. Where from the opinion comes, where is the person who gives the opinion, or what the origin of that person? Maybe the person is in United States, but what kind of person? Is it Indian? Is it European? Some words about more specifically what I mean here. This is probably the main part, properly sentiment analysis. We call it polarity or emotion, polarity detection, polarity classification or emotion detection. It's an easy task. Okay. It is a clear task because it's just binary classification, a six-way classification for emotions. Of course, you don't need to do it in a binary way. It can be measured like 0.6 positive, or it can be number of stars, one star, two stars, five stars. But more or less, it's about yes or no, and degrees of yes and no. There is a good interpretation agreement. If you show the same text to several people, they probably will have the same opinion about whether the text is positive or negative, which gives us clear evaluation. What we quite lack in other areas like machine translation, it's more difficult to evaluate machine translation. Mostly a classification task, which is good for machine learning. We all do machine learning, so it's a good application. It seems simple as compared with other natural language processing tasks, where you need to build complex structures, you need to reason in complex ways. Here you just classify. And still, it has enough interaction with the rich structure of the text. Still, I feel it's a more complex and more interesting task in a way than classification in some other data types, where there's that data are much more homogeneous. And text has its own structure. So what I want for polarity, polarity detection, polarity classification, is like this. Here I type tourism. And our demo program, written by my Indian student, said, okay, most people like tourism, based on some tweets. And this is a joke. Nobody likes work. Everybody likes tourism. Linux. Okay, people mostly like Linux. No. Windows. No, it's Microsoft. Okay, so this is kind of thing that I would like to see, but this is a demo. It doesn't work well. And now, what's difficult about it? As in any task, you can do 80% of quality in one day. It's trivial to get 80% of quality. But then 90% of quality, you already have to fight for it. So what's difficult about this task? What you don't have in many other data sets.